Good afternoon. My name is Dave Pettigo, and I am the Vice President of Emerging Technologies for CEDIA. I would like to thank you for coming to Integrated Systems Europe 2017, and welcome you to the final CEDIA talk of 2017. I'd like to introduce Peter Aylett. Peter is an outstanding volunteer, former Volunteer of the Year, Educator of the Year for CEDIA, and he is the Technical Director of Archimedia, which is based out of the Middle East. And with that, Peter, I'll hand it over.
Thanks, Dave. Hi, everyone. How are you doing? Thank you very much for coming today. For about the next 20 minutes, we are going to be talking about some of the things that are going to be happening over the next few years in terms of user experiences and business models. I'm technical director for quite a large residential integration company based in the Middle East, and pretty much everything I talk about today is very, very focused towards the residential market. We as a company, we do the whole gamut of residential stuff. In 2016, we were very privileged to win a CEDIA award for best integrated home for a really, really fabulous place. And we also managed to win a best yacht installation. And although these kinds of projects, you could say, are relatively few and far between, when it comes down to it, my vision of these kind of thing is that actually a big project is just a collection of lots of little projects put together. Although these places are big and the value is large, really the value is large because there are lots of rooms. If you take these things room by room by room, we end up having a very, very scalable industry. And this is what we, and I reckon probably most of you do, we design, deliver, and curate no compromise technology experiences for people. Many, many different definitions of what we do as an industry. We could stand here, we could sit here, we could debate for hours and hours and hours and hours. But fundamentally, I think this is what we do. And every year I come here, it's the same conversation. Everyone's standing around going, oh no, there's so many changes. How do I keep up? My business model's changing. Technology is changing. But when you look at it, yeah, absolutely. We've had the fabulous Dave talk about gaming. We've had the fabulous Rich Green talk about VR, AR, mixed reality. Some of my other tech council colleagues have been talking about TV in the year 2000, control, interfacing with technology, and maintenance in 2020 rather. So yes, absolutely, technology is increasing at an incredible rate. But also our business models are evolving, and this is really what I want to talk about today. My colleagues have been covering the business side. What I want to talk about is how do those technologies affect our businesses. If you look at this, you can see that the possibilities are really, really, really huge in terms of the financial probability of the growth of our industry. We're sort of here in 2020, huge amount of growth, 2025, huge amount of growth, 2030, huge amount of growth. And what this means is that we actually have a problem. And that problem is that everyone these days thinks they're an expert. We have got a lot of entrants coming into the market. Significantly, this is a very, very recent announcement. Amazon now have a service where for free you can book an Amazon expert in some cities in the US to come and talk to you about technology in your home. And they have lots of very sophisticated survey tools. They will look at your wireless network, they'll look at your wired network, they'll look at the technology you have, and then suggest from a very, very highly and tightly curated catalog things that you can do in your house. 100 hours of training. I've been in this industry now for about 28 years. I'm sure many of you have been here for longer. We are learning every single day of our professional lives. And I'm just not sure that 100 hours makes you an expert. But this is the reality that we're living in. And this is a reality that we cannot ignore and we have to deal with. Disintermediation, what does that word mean? Who can give me a definition of the word disintermediation? Really simply, it means cutting out the middleman. companies going direct to the consumer, bypassing us as a professional channel. And the reality is, we don't own this space anymore. We do not own the home technology space. We as professionals. There are security companies, there are electrical contracting companies, there are aerial and satellite installers looking at this space as a really, really big opportunity. There are utility companies who are trying to make up for lost revenues selling their traditional products, looking at our channel at all these opportunities. So whereas 10, 15 years ago, we had largely experts working with a very tightly curated set of products that critically were very, very limited distribution, the public couldn't buy those. Today, we're working in a very, very different marketplace where we have experts selling products that are basically available to everyone. This is disintermediation. And the other problem that we have is everything's smart these days. I was at the Consumer Electronics Show earlier in January, and you cannot get away from that word smart. Everything these days is labeled smart. TVs, smart. Washing machines, smart. Pet feeders, smart. Fridges, smart. Remote controls, smart. Everything is smart. But when we look at this word smart, we really need to take that down to basics and consider, actually, are these things smart, or is there something else that makes them smart? Today, I'm saying this word smart a lot, aren't I? You can go out and buy a smart connected LED bulb. Now, that can mean many things, but if you go back to when the electric light bulb was invented, when the electric light bulb was invented, the word electric had to be in front of it to differentiate it from a gas bulb. It was an electric bulb. Give it maybe 2, 3, 4 years, I don't think we're going to be seeing smart bulbs anymore. I think we're just going to be seeing bulbs. Because the reality is that once everything is smart, then in effect, nothing is smart anymore because smart becomes the baseline. And given that this industry, that chart I showed you earlier, projecting the revenues from smart home technologies, you look at the majority of surveys out there, you look at the question that is asked by the pollster, and you know what pollsters are like. They can get any answer they like based on the question they ask. But the question that the public are normally asked, the word that the public cling on to, is this word smart. Now, what can we do as an industry to really differentiate ourselves from this disintermediated, mass market, so-called expert thing that's around us? Well, the first thing we can look at are ecosystems, and this shows some of them. These are mainly physical layer technologies. There's a lot of, you know, software, abstract software layers included. But rather than things becoming easier, yes, a single product you pick up, manufacturers are making them phenomenally easy to configure. The idea is it's very much a DIY product. But you then take that product and put it into an ecosystem. You then have other ecosystems potentially working in that property or in that building. You can end up with something that is inherently very, very complex. But what I'd argue, and I think this is a really important concept for us, is actually all these things are just tools. I am a completely inept carpenter. If you give me a load of really, really superb carpentry tools, I will make you something that is completely hideous. You give those exact same tools to a skilled cabinet maker, and they will produce you something that is absolutely amazing. Is the industry changing? Well, kind of. Is technology changing? Yeah. Are business opportunities changing? Yeah. Are business relationships changing? Yeah. But really, the only change is the fact that that toolbox is getting bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. And we, as professionals, we can't go, oh no, you know, these people don't know what they're doing, or no, I'm just gonna sit in my little cuddled up cotton wool world and ignore all the changes out there. We have to embrace these changes, and we have to know how to use these tools better than anybody else. This is the absolute essence of our future. We cannot fight the toolbox. We've got to learn how to use that toolbox. And this is absolutely, it's one of those funny little cartoons, but this is exactly what's happening. Why don't we have interoperability? Why don't we have this wonderfully interoperable set of technologies out there that you just plug them in, they touch the network, and they work? Could we do that, have that tomorrow? Yeah, absolutely. It's not the technology that is causing us to have systems that are not interoperable. It's the manufacturers themselves, ring fencing, firewalling, whatever you want to call it, their little ecosystem, and saying, you buy into our ecosystem, and we only want you to use products that work within that particular ecosystem. So if you look at the services that Amazon are offering, if you look at services that your utility providers are offering, if you look at services that all of these new entrants into the market are offering, what is almost certain is they will be offering a user experience based on one particular ecosystem. They will be curating something for the customer based on a very, very, very tightly chosen set of products, and those products have been tested to be interoperable. That's how they can get away with the 100 hours of training. They really don't have to think about it. We, as industry professionals, have a huge, huge opportunity because we have the same access to the toolbox. They're kind of like me. I can build an IKEA flat pack as well as anyone. It's a tightly curated set of things that go together just like something within an ecosystem. Give me loads of bits of wood to create things from different stuff, hopeless. And I predict it's going to be the same with a lot of the new entrants into the marketplace. And that is how we're going to compete. And it doesn't matter what you call yourself. Lots of different ways that we can phrase ourselves. One of these days, we must decide what we want to call ourselves. It's like that conversation you have at a pub. What do you do? I'm a lawyer. Okay, what kind of lawyer? Mergers and acquisitions. The conversation stops there. I'm a nurse. Oh, fantastic. What kind of nurse? Intensive care. The conversation stops there. We as an industry must get together, and I urge you to really get involved and follow CEDIA's leadership on this so that we can work together to build something that is really, really recognized by the public. If we just go out there and do our own thing, then this fragmentation of what we call ourselves is going to continue. And CEDIA are absolutely the leaders within this, and I really urge you to become part of the CEDIA community and build this conversation so that we can all market ourselves as one single thing with clarity. But the essence of smart, I don't think products are smart anymore. Products are not the thing that is smart. The thing that is smart are the people. People are smart. We're entering the age of adaptive and intuitive automation with the digitization of our environments. You know, this is a real quantum shift. We're going beyond the smart building, and we're entering the age of the intuitive building. And that with it is going to bring a lot of opportunities. We need to create experiences that are frictionless. And when I say frictionless, the best technology is no technology. You've all been to websites where it's probably about 20 clicks between putting something in your shopping basket and actually, you know, checking out at the end. That is friction. When you go shopping to a supermarket, I go to a supermarket where I scan things as I put them in the bags. Then at the end, I just simply scan a barcode and all my shopping is already packed. I don't have to then put it into bags at the checkout. That's reducing friction. Our jobs is to curate our customers' experience with technology to reduce that friction with it. We also need to integrate things aesthetically. How much skill does this take? How much skill does it take to integrate technology aesthetically into an environment, to hide things, to install things into cabinetry, to run cables, to elegantly do patch panels to give our customers flexibility? Do you think this is something that can be done with 100 hours of training? Absolutely not. Those highly curated ecosystems are standalone retail devices that you plug in. They're not things that are integrated into the fabric of the building. And finally, maximize performance. You can get some okay kind of performance from something that's sort of that big as a speaker, but is that really going to capture someone emotionally when they listen to music? Absolutely not. So we have a massive opportunity to take performance off the charts relative to these consumerized, commoditized products. And another really, really essential part of what you will need to be doing in the future is focusing on your brand as a company. Your companies, whether you like it or not, have a brand. You might not know what that brand is. You might not have ever considered what that brand is. But that brand is an incredibly important thing to consider. We as a company install many different types of products. We do Crestron, we do Savant, we do Bowes & Wilkins, we do Bang & Olufsen. These are all iconic brands. These are all brands that have a huge amount of recognition from the public. But you can buy those brands at lots and lots and lots of different places. Your visual brand is just the tip of the iceberg. Don't think that a logo is just your brand. And the reality of that brand is that if I want to buy a Bang & Olufsen system, I can go to many, many different places to buy it. If I want to buy an Archimedia system, there is only one company in the world that can sell that, and that is Archimedia. You are the brand. Stop selling products. You do not sell that stuff. If you go to Mercedes, do you say to Mercedes, oh, can you give me a bill of materials for the car, please? Of course you don't. You buy the car. Are you bothered who makes the fuel injection system? Are you worried about who makes the foam inside the seats? You could probably ask these questions, but you are buying a Mercedes. You are not buying a collection of individual components. And the reason you're buying a Mercedes and you're not buying a Kia and you're not buying a Hyundai, because arguably those cars are getting pretty much as good as a Mercedes these days, I promise you, the smaller ones. You're buying a Mercedes because of the brand cachet. And this is something we have to consider in our companies. This is a touchpoints wheel. And it describes some of the ways, it's not a complete list, it describes some of the ways that our customers interact with us pre-sale, during sale, and post-sale. Every one of these touchpoints affects the brand of your company. So don't just focus on the technical side of things. I don't know many companies that go out of business because they're not technically good enough. I know lots of companies that go out of business because they're not brand focused and they're not cash flow focused. They don't have the brand to differentiate themselves in the marketplace and they run out of cash. You must develop your brands. We are Archimedia. We spend a huge amount of time on our brand. We were really, really gratified last week because we were looking through a property brochure and someone was selling a very, very large villa on the Palm in Dubai. And there was a section at the bottom that said upgrades. And two things were listed. Two upgrades that he'd done to the house. Upgrade number one was a Gaggenau kitchen. You all know Gaggenau kitchens. You know, really, really renowned brand. Upgrade number two, Archimedia system. It didn't even say Archimedia Automation. It didn't even say Archimedia AV. It said Archimedia System. And we looked at that and thought, huh, we're doing something right in our marketplace because we sold an Archimedia system. They didn't say it was Savant. They didn't say it was Bowes & Wilkins. It doesn't matter what the products you use are. Every single product out there is fantastic. These manufacturers are doing an amazing job with the stuff. It's difficult to buy a bad product. It's very, very easy to have someone incompetent try and put them together. And this is where you need to stand out. You need to build your competence. You need to build your brand. It's my favorite quote by Johnny Ive at Apple, and I'll sort of waffle on for a few seconds whilst you read that. But have a look at the bit, "As excited is to make great products." I've changed that slightly. "And what makes us excited is to create reliable, inspirational, and frictionless experiences." This is all of us, ISE 2017. If you are focused on your customers, don't focus on your brands. Focus on your company as a brand and not the brands you sell. Design things. Spend time with your customers to understand their needs. Install things according to recommended practices. Attend CEDIA education courses. Download all the fantastic CEDIA white papers. The CEDIA Technology Council is now going to be doing at least 2 webcasts, podcasts a month. Those are brilliant. You know, there's some old farts like us just rambling on about what we think. Fantastic. Download it. Listen to it in the car on the way to work. Do everything you can to immerse yourself in the world of how are you going to deliver superb experiences to your customers. Because I promise you, you all have the potential to do things that guy with 100 hours of training and that really, really highly curated product set simply can't. And all that company is doing, that company I showed you earlier, they are saying, hey, there's this fantastic world out there of home automation, of home entertainment, of security, of health, of maintenance. They are advertising your industry for you. And the way that you're going to access that work is to focus on your skills, to focus on design, and focus on your brand. Embrace change. Don't fear it. Design is what is smart. People are expensive. Things are cheap. This is the new reality. Once upon a time, things were expensive and people were cheap. Now, we're all working with the same commoditized stuff. The thing that makes the difference is the skill of the people designing it, the skill of the people integrating it. And please, please, please focus on your brand. Hope that wasn't too fast. That was my perspective of what's going to happen in the year 2020. And you know what? If you agree with me, come and say hello. If you disagree with me, sign up to CEDIA Communities, start a thread, and let's have the conversation. What I said today is not the truth. It is one of many, many, many different truths. It's one of many, many different paths that you can take your company. And it's fantastic if we share these things. We can either look at ourselves as competitors, or we can look at ourselves as a community of free business consultants. So I urge you, sign up to CEDIA Communities, get involved in CEDIA events, become a CEDIA volunteer, share your experiences, and if you do all those things and focus on your company as a brand, not on selling those things, you are selling Mercedes cars. You are not selling the bill of materials that makes up that car, then you will absolutely fly as a company. Thank you very much, and I hope you have a really good rest of the day and a fantastic show.